Well, good morning, Grace Chapel. How's everybody doing? Hey, it's good to see everybody this morning. We're excited to be here as we continue into our Easter Revival Sundays. Remember to be here, invite somebody. Next week, I'll be speaking. The following week, Pastor Ricky, and then we got Monty, we got Scott, and then we got John Jenkins. So we still got a lot of speakers lined up. It's been great so far. Amen. Amen. So today George will be speaking, so we're excited to hear that message. So just look at your neighbor and take a moment and tell him good morning. Tell him it's good to see him in the house of the Lord. That's a mouthful, isn't it? Here, we'll say it together. It's good to see you in the house of the Lord. Amen. If you're watching online, we welcome you. If you're down in our other building, we welcome you as well. Can you stand with me this morning as we just prepare our hearts? Just a reminder to our youth, if you are going to camp, today is the sign-ups and the deposit is due. And we have to have that. We're doing it different instead of extending sign-ups. And the reason is because we have to have a number to give them by today. Or, well, by tomorrow morning, actually. So Katie's got to give that number in so that they can reserve our room. So if you are going to camp, reminder, today is the last day to sign up. And the deposit is due. Now, we're going to do some fundraisers for the rest of the money, but we need your help. So parents and youth, make sure you look out for those things that are coming up. Also, remember the Hands of Hope Golf Tournament. It's coming up pretty quick. If you have any questions, please see George. And then our Grace kids are going to be having a day camp. So make sure you grab a bulletin when you come in each day so that you can read some of these announcements and take it. As I always say, you can also get discounts at some restaurants. Bill?
Also, remember
Roman
Pine, the fish fry on Friday night. I think it's starting towards the 5 o'clock.
6 o'clock, the fish fry. Drive through. Okay, so fish fry, there's a sign-up sheet, fish fry, 6 o'clock, drive through, grab it, and it's going to go to sponsor a hole. And Ray caught all the fish, so awesome. You're helping a lot of local people, right? Ray don't sell it, he just gives it away, but you're supporting him being able to fish more. So Ray's down in our other building, so he is catching a lot of fish, and it is good. So please support that. If you have any questions, see Bill, see George. They'd be happy to answer that. Amen? Hey, can we just lift our hands in the room today towards heaven and just close our eyes a moment just to prepare our hearts for today? Lord, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for this season that we are in of this Easter time, God, that we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. And God, we don't just celebrate that on one particular Sunday, but we celebrate that throughout the year. Because you're an awesome God. And God, we thank you for what you're going to do today. In Jesus' name, amen.
My burden. for that this morning. Amen. I thought of two things during that psalm. The first thing, if he's the well that never runs dry, if we're thirsty, why? Come on. Somebody help me out. Angel got the answer. So if he's the well that never runs dry and we are thirsty, then what's the problem? We're not drinking, right? So amen. So I say, Lord, let us drink of you this morning. Lord, let us receive of you today. And I bless him for that this morning. We're just so glad you're here. And I'll tell you the second thing in just a minute. But we're grateful that you're here and in the house of the Lord. Again, those that, as Paul said, that are listening online, that are in their youth building. And to those that would be listening, if this part gets on the radio program, we're just grateful for everyone today to be in the house of the Lord. I know we've got several families, some that are traveling today. Other families that are sick, but I'm glad you're here today. Amen. And just to receive the hand of the Lord today. We want to pray for them. We want to continue to pray one for another. Again, as I was watching Vicky, I was thinking about John. And we miss John being here. And so we want to continue to pray for John Jr. and their whole family. And, of course, this week we celebrated TG's mom, Mary Stamper's homecoming, and we want to pray for them. Also, some of you would remember Catherine and Jimmy Idol, that was a part of the church quite a number of years ago. We did her funeral service on Monday of this week. And so we want to pray for Hope and that entire family and just believe the grace of God to be extended to them. Amen. Would you pray with me today? Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, there are so many needs in life. Lord, life, you taught us that, Lord, even not to worry about tomorrow. God, for another day's troubles are sufficient of itself. And Lord, that doesn't picture a life of defeat, but Lord, it just pictures a life that we're going to face difficulties as long as we're in this side of eternity. Lord, I'm so grateful, Lord, that in every one of them, Lord, that you have made us more than conquerors, Lord, that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And Lord, I bless you for that today. Lord, I bless you for the touch of heaven, God, to flow, Lord, is only God, Lord, it can flow from heaven, Lord, for you are the fountainhead of all life today. And Lord, as that fountainhead flows, God, unto every aspect, to every body, to every emotion, to every situation, Lord, I know it's Ezekiel's river. God brought life, so God, the fountain, Lord, as it flows from heaven, Lord, that never runs dry, brings life. So we thank you for that. We thank you that we'll meet with you today. We'll hear from you, and we take a moment now to pray for our nation. We pray today, God, for revival again, that as we've been said many times, it'd be a grassroots revival, Lord, that would start here, start in the local church, and God, then spread throughout our nation, even to our, Lord, to our leadership of our nation. So we pray for revival. We pray for truth to abound, every lie to be defeated in Jesus' name. Father, we pray that every thing that the enemy would want to do, even in secret, Lord, will be revealed and it'll be brought down and destroyed in Jesus' name. And Lord, we believe the plans of righteousness, Lord, to be established. And Lord, we pray as Lord, you taught us to pray, Lord, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And the church says, amen. Amen. Well, just another couple of things I want to remind you about. Prayer time that's been moved to the church, 6 o'clock tomorrow. 6:15 tomorrow night, but also the Zoom availability is still there. We had some Zooming in last week, but we have went back to live prayer on Monday night, so we encourage you, if you can, to come out and pray and seek the Lord. We'll be on week 18 this week of our study through the book of Romans on Wednesday night, so trust that you'll be with us as we continue to walk that pathway. I want to say just real quickly two things. Thank you. If you've not noticed the playground, take a look at it. I know that we've raised money for that back in, I think, almost 6 or 8 months ago, maybe longer. But it was completed yesterday, and so take a look at that to see the way the new playground looks down there. And so we're grateful for that being done. Thankful to Monty's crew that was able to get it done. So I appreciate that. Also, I appreciate we ended up having two applicants for the administrative position. I appreciate our council team that interviewed them this past Tuesday evening, I believe it was, or Thursday evening. And so the council will be making that decision this coming Tuesday night. So thanks for your prayers, and we'll be making that announcement come next Sunday morning. Amen. Well, again, we're glad you're here. The other thing I thought is with singing, that burdens are lifted away. And we're coming these weeks to focus on the cross. Amen. That's what our focus is, because of preaching of the cross may be foolishness to the world. But to we that are saved, it is the power of God. We know that our life, our victory was in the cross. There could have not been a resurrection had there not been someone paid the penalty of death on the cross. I'm so glad that he was wounded for my transgressions. How about you? He was bruised for my iniquities. The chastisement of my peace was upon him, and by his stripes were healed. But as I thought about that song, as Angel even began this morning, I thought of another old song that I say that a lot, old songs, I guess because I'm getting older, I don't know. But I was thinking of it today, that burdens are lifted at Calvary. Do you remember that little chorus, just the chorus of that song? Can we just sing that before she goes back into worship, before you bring your offering? Would you just sing that chorus through a couple of times, and then we'll be ready to come and worship the Lord with our tithe and offerings.
Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Thank you. Rest on.
was pretty weak. Stand back up. Now, we just talked about the goodness of God, and I heard about five people shouting glory and clapping their hands. Amen. I believe God's a good God, right? Do you really believe that? He's good regardless of how I'm feeling. He's good regardless of how my week's been. He's good regardless of if I've got my stimulus check or not. I mean, he's good if I'm getting one or not, right? He's good, right? But hey, I'm glad our dependence is not upon the government. It's on God, and he's a good God. So I think one more time we ought to shout praise and give God. He's a good God. He's a good God. He's a good God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, my Lord. Amen. You can sit down. Too many times we let the ceiling that the enemy and our circumstances define our praise. Think about that. We let the ceiling that the enemy and our weeks been, our feelings been, define our praise. So in other words, if things aren't going quite like we like, or we're not feeling quite like we like, then that creates a ceiling that says my praise is not going to go any higher than that. Come on, somebody say amen. You know I'm telling you the truth, right? Because that ceiling dictates our level of praise. And I'm just persuaded of this. We stay below that ceiling because we allow our praise to stay below that ceiling. Amen? Come on, right? Instead of saying, I may not feel it today, right? I may have had a bad week. Things may have felt like all hell crumbled around me today. But I'm going to praise God because he's good regardless, right? He is good regardless in all things, right? He said all things work together for my good, right? To those who love him, to those who are called according to his purposes. And the Bible says what? In everything. Come on, in everything, not just in good things, but in everything, give thanks. Why? Because his goodness and his faithfulness and his love never changes. Amen. So I'm going to be determined that I'm not going to let anything else determine my praise except his worthiness. Amen. And then I believe I break through the ceiling and I get into that heavenly place where God can share with me all the things of the Spirit that he wants to in my life. Amen. Well, I'm thankful Vicki's going to minister to us a song today. And I wanted to say something before she does. You know, I'm grateful someone may say, well, why is she still signing since John is in heaven now? And can hear very well today, amen? But it's because we know there's other people out there. There's an unreached people group that a lot of people never reach out to that can't hear, that need to see someone sharing the message of Christ with them. And understand this, Vicki's message, our church services, and I don't remember all the places, but it's different places of the world this service goes to because of Vicki. Because people share the broadcast in different groups of sign language in different parts of the world. And so they're able, not only is her outreach going, but enables our outreach to go further around the world. I say thank God for that, amen. I think that's something to celebrate. So celebrate Vicki as she ministers this morning. Free man.
like lightning hit my veins. My dead heart began to beat. Breath of God filled my lungs, and the Holy Ghost awakened me. Yeah, the Holy Ghost.
In the house. Amen. Thank you, Vicki. Praise God for that. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for that. Well, we are, again, as Paul said earlier, in week two of our Easter Sunday morning revival services, and you say this is a strange type of revival service as well. It's a strange day we're living in, and a different day if you haven't noticed, but I really felt that we, as we recognize the gifts of God that God has placed in our midst, and the people of God, and all of them won't be up here in these weeks, but have a call of God, a message of God. I believe this, God gives someone a message and a calling for a purpose and for a reason. And when God establishes boundaries, when they are a part of our family, they're a part of our family and they have the word for a reason. Does that make sense to anyone? And I believe that today. And I'm thankful. Last week, as Brother Paul Lane shared with us, and he's away ministering today, but I appreciated the word of the Lord that he brought to us. Brother Paul McGinnis will share next Sunday morning. But I'm excited. All these guys prepare. All these guys give detail to seeking the Lord. But I don't know of anyone more than George when he prepares and he takes his time to be in this pulpit very, very seriously. And I'm excited this morning to hear what he has to say about the cross. Would you welcome him this morning?
Pearl, would you grab me some water out of the side there? Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. Kind words. And it's a pretty daunting task, but thank you for the opportunity to speak. Today is Mission Sunday, and we do want to do the missions offering. If somebody would just bring the suitcase, I'm just up here barking out orders, aren't I? So somebody would bring the suitcase up here where we'll take the offering when it gets up here. You could just follow behind it. But I do want to give you an update, some exciting things happening in the world at Foursquare Missions. Thank you, Burl. And I got word this week that I'm really excited about. My brother-in-law is from Italy. And he talks about Italy a lot on Sunday afternoons when we meet with my mother-in-law. We go over there every Sunday afternoon. And I've always wanted to travel to Italy. We had a trip planned to Italy for last year in the fall, and it got canceled, of course, like everything else. And so, but we're going to open a Bible Institute on the southern tip in the boot of Italy. And we're going to get to be a part of that. And I say we're, I mean you, we, us. Okay, amen. And so we're going to get to be a part of that. And it's a very dry place. Very dry, and it needs the Spirit of God there, and so we're going to get to be a part of it. You guys can come on forward if you have an offering, and just place it in the suitcase there. And just as an update, Daniel and Yolanda Rivera have their tickets on the 31st. They'll depart. It's a one-way ticket to Puerto Rico, one way. And so they won't be coming back for probably at least a year, which they'll come back and start sharing what God has been doing in Puerto Rico. We will be a part of that. I'm excited about that. They're going to be opening a dream center. I hope to go down in June, help them search for some property. There's a lot of closed schools there. And just pray for the favor of God that that the government would give us one of those schools to open to start counseling, teaching, doing different things, all in the name of Jesus. Amen. And so Mike and his wife's name is escaping me right now in Tanzania. Are still praying for their work permits. Continue to pray for them. Some of you guys have seen online that Jorge and Jessica are in the process of buying some land and clearing some land for a training center in Panama. And so I hope to make a trip to Panama probably in August, and Italy probably September, October time frame. So pray. I did want to share one other thing for you. So my new role will be missions pastor. And so, you know, I had something shared with me this week that really struck me. But so a guy was, a pastor was talking about him interviewing somebody for a missions pastor role, okay? So thank you that I didn't have to interview for that. The requirements for the interview was tell me what you have done locally that I should make you a missions pastor. Well, I'm just going to say we have local outreach, but I think we have a lot of work to do yet locally. Amen? And so join with me in that. You'll see outside in the foyer there area, I've started to put the newsletters of all the ministries that we're supporting, and so you can pick up I usually put like five or six of them out there, so anytime you want to just read what's going on in the local missions, you can do that. And so Dottie and I drove to Pensacola 2 weeks ago, picked up a coffee machine, and so we're hoping to have our coffee, Sunrise Coffee Shop, back up and running. And all of the ministries of our church, the men's, women's, the youth, the children's ministry and the missions ministry will be working that. And so we'll be sharing in the funds that come through that into their local mission. So praise God what he's going to do there as well. So I'm thankful for that. So let me just get started. So I want to share a word that I was very much instructed with this morning. And that word is infused. Infused. Okay. Anybody heard that word recently? Huh? Anybody remember that word recently? Anybody? Come on. Have you heard that word recently, Pastor? Where did you hear that word?
Stimulus infused into the economy.
No? No?
I didn't hear that.
You didn't hear it?
I heard that.
Huh? You not heard the word infused recently? Our pastor led off this series last week with the word infused. 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 Amen. And I'm telling you what, I think it was a word for a time. It's a word for a season. I want to just give you a little background on that word. Okay. In the dictionary, if you look it up, it says to soak. Okay. To fill or to pervade. Okay. And Pastor's prayer was last week, as we encounter this season of revival, is that we as a church would be infused, okay, with the Word of God, yes, with prayer, and that on the other side there would be change.
Yes.
All right. Infuse, to introduce one thing into another so as to affect it throughout.
Absolutely.
Who? You know, I immediately went to our offices right down the street from DaVita, okay, dialysis. So people go there and they're infused, right?
Yes.
With some chemical, the way I understand it. And what is it? It invades their body and it goes throughout, and it's to kill something else, right? It's to change things that are going. You know, and as we go through this series, I believe all of our prayers should be, right, that as we go through this series of the revival, that we should be infused with the power of the Holy Spirit, with the Word of God, right? That our lives would be changed throughout. See, infuse implies a pouring in of something that gives, listen, new life.
Yes.
Or significance.
Yes.
I'm going to read that again. Infuse implies a pouring in of something that gives new life or significance.
Yes.
So let's be infused this
yes.
morning. Amen.
Yes.
Not only this morning, but I hope you were infused last Sunday.
Yes.
I hope you'll be infused next Sunday when Paul McGinnis is speaking. I hope you'll be infused on Easter Sunday when our pastor is preaching. I hope you'll be infused the following week when Monty Monteith is speaking. I hope you'll be infused the following week when Scott Smith is speaking. And I hope you'll be infused when our brother John Jenkins comes to a new church. A new church, as Paul McGinnis proclaimed last Sunday. Amen. Let's be changed, right? It's time to quit playing church, right? You know, my brother in Greeley, Colorado, you know George Klein, but the radio station he works for, he has a church called The Real Church. The Real Church. It's called The Real Church. And it's druggies, you name it. It's everything. Everything. They feed them every Sunday morning. And God is doing miracles. The real church. You know what? Let's be the real church.
Yes.
Let's be real. Amen?
Yes.
Let's be real. The second he mentioned is, Pastor Ricky mentioned, do you remember what you mentioned second? Your quiz is over. I'll let him off the hook. He mentioned to throw off that which is not needed. Amen?
Yes.
We are to throw off. So let us remove some things from our lives. Amen?
Yes.
Let us remove some things in our life that drag us down, right? Day in and day out, things that have drug us down. And let's bring some live things in our lives. Let's be infused with the good things, right?
Yes.
The things of the Holy Spirit. Third, he mentioned to cut the ropes
yes.
to the safety boats,
yes.
right? A lot of us are holding on to some safety ropes, right?
Right?
And those ropes are nothing but flesh, right? They're nothing but insecurity from the devil, the lie that is speaking to us. And so let's cut the ropes. You remember, yeah, most of you have heard the story. I don't know if they're teaching it anymore in our education system, but when the people come over from England, what did they do? Does anybody know what they did to the boats? They burned them, right? They said, you know, we ain't going back. Right? We ain't going back. Right? It's time to go into a place, right, when we're done on April 25th, that we're at a place, right, that we're not going back.
Yes. Yes.
That we're not going back. Amen?
Yes.
It's time to go to that place. So let our safety and our security be in Him and Him alone. Amen?
Yes. Thank you.
Amen? You hear me? It's time.
Yes.
It's time. What does Paul Lane say? I want you to get this. I want you to get this. Will you get this morning? Amen. I love my brother. You know, Brother Paul spoke an incredible word last week, and that video was powerful too. You know, the word that he spoke was from Hebrews 12, and I'm going to read this to you because it was this word was instrumental in my life change when I encountered the cross. Hebrews 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off, right? Did we just hear that?
Yes.
Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles us, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us.
Right.
Is that powerful?
Yes.
You know, we need to infuse ourselves with that word. Amen?
Yes.
Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of faith. Okay, some of you might feel like a pioneer out there, right? A little pioneer, a little perfecter. It may not be so easy sometimes, but he does it through us. Amen. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Amen. Is that a powerful word? You know, that was a powerful kickoff. And that was, what was that, Paul? Was that the foundation? I'm painting walls today. Is that right? Paul poured the foundation? That's right. We're building a house here in the next 7 weeks. Remember that? Remember. So the cross. I want to give you a little personal testimony of myself about the cross, okay? When I encountered the cross, I was at a very dark place in my life, like many of us probably are, right? And so we're like, what's going on in my life? Something's got to change. There's something more to life than this, right? So I was standing, I'm just going to say, on this side of the cross, okay? And we'll talk about this side of the cross. And I was down. Many of us are down. And I was wanting to encounter salvation, right? But I didn't know how to get there. And guess what? I didn't trust God enough. I didn't trust him. I wasn't willing to go all in. I didn't know if he was the one, right? I didn't know. I didn't know if I could say, okay, I'm gonna accept that he died for me, right? Yes. He gave his life for me, and my life will be changed through that, you know? And so I wrestled. And I'll tell you how much I wrestled, okay? Here's a book, okay? And this is a powerful book, Josh McDowell, Evidence That Demands a Verdict, okay? Some of you have heard of this book, okay? Okay, this book has two volumes, right? Well, I finished volume one, and I still wasn't convinced, okay? All right, so there's a volume two, all right? And this book's like 300-something pages, right? And I finished it, and I went before, you know, myself, I guess, praying to the Lord and just, you know, seeking revelation. And God gave it to me. God gave it to me. He changed my life. He saved me. He became my Savior, you know. And this, you know, this book, the amazing part about this book is Josh McDowell did the same thing. Okay, he sought out. He wrote this book, okay, because he sought out to prove, right, that Jesus was not the Savior. He sought out to prove it wrong, okay? I was kind of wanting to prove it right, you know, because as I read the Bible, I had never read anything so much about love, right? And when I seen the wisdom in the book with just the little bit of wisdom that I had as a young man, I was like, this has to be a deity. It has to be a God, right? And so I read volume two, and I got saved. And my life changed forever, okay? And so if you know somebody that's struggling, this book is written for youth. It's written for young people. It's written in different translations. Powerful, powerful book. But, you know, in my searching, I had to find out who God was. God was. I needed to know more about him, because if I didn't know him, how could I trust him to save me, right? So I had to understand who God was. And so I sought out to do that over here. So I'm over here on this side of the cross, and I'm going, who is this God? And I'm reading this book, and I'm reading all this material, and I'm praying, and I'm seeking, and I'm like, God, reveal the answer to me as to what's going on, you know? And I'm just going to be honest with you, very honest, okay? As we seek our revelation about the cross, many times, yes, we want salvation, maybe, because we're dealing with this, we're wrestling with this thing about eternity, right? Where you know, the most asked question on the planet Earth is where am I going to go when I die? Okay, I'm just going to tell you that is the most asked question. Okay, and the majority of the time it's not asked verbally. Okay, it's running around in people's heads. Where am I going to go? Where am I going to go? Where am I going to go? What's going to happen to me when I die? Okay? And so I was wrestling with that. At the same time, I was wrestling with the fact that, you know, I thought I was going to be a millionaire, and I found out I was just going to be a normal guy. Right? I thought I had it all to be a millionaire, right? And I was all this. What does Paul say? All that and something, I don't know, a bag of chips, yeah. Yeah, I'm stealing all his thing today, all his thing, okay. All that and a bag of chips, I thought I had it all, I was going to be a millionaire, right? And I found myself leaned up against the back of a couch, crying my eyes out, lost everything, and said, what is going on here, you know? And then out of that came, okay, well, where am I going to go when I die? So I had two answers. You know, many of us have, we might approach the cross with, you know, Lord, heal me. Whoever you are, heal me. Lord, save me. Lord, provide for me. Whatever it may be on this side, we have to encounter God, and we're looking for the answers to these questions. Amen? We're looking, and that's what I was doing, is I was looking for the answers to those questions. Why are these pages duplicating? I don't know. So on this side of the cross, there's a penalty, right? If I don't get saved, there's a penalty, right? That penalty is a strong penalty, right? But on this side of the cross, right, there's reward, right? There's reward on this side. So I had to get there. I had to encounter the cross, right? And I had to go through. So the penalty, you know, is bondage, right? It's bondage. It's being condemned. It's guilty. It's being separated from God. Amen? But on the other side, there's freedom. There's justification. There's being forgiven. There's redeemed. There's all those good things, right? And I needed to get there, and praise God I did. Hallelujah. Praise God I did. You know, I watched the video again this morning, and you know, in this congregation, I know Paul Lane counted five people that raised their hands last week. I watched them. I see that hand. There was five of them,
right,
in this body. Right. Five. And then when he asked the question about, you know, do you need to move on in your life? You're saved, but there were six. There were six last week, right? So we all find ourselves in these places, don't we? Right, where we need to encounter the cross. Sometimes we need to revisit that cross, encounter it again, and be refreshed as to what happened there, right? But when we do that, see, we have to trust in this God, right? And not only is our God of our salvation, right? He's a God, our healer, right? He's a God, our provider. He's the banner. He's our love. He's everything to us. See, when Moses went up on the mount, right? Moses encountered the God, right? Okay, now Moses was given a promise, right? He was given a promise that he would go into, right? He would go in and pull the Israelites out, right? He would go in. God was telling him he would do that, right? And so when Moses got those instructions, right, he said to God, he says, well, who and what authority? In what authority am I to tell the Pharaoh, right? He's talking to a king. He's going to go talk to a king, right? Right? He's going to go talk to a king. In what authority am I going to go in there and say, I'm coming to pull the Israelites out, okay? And not only that, he had to go to the Israelites and say to them, right? God has given me this authority that we're coming out. We're coming out. And not only we're coming out, but we're going in to the promised land, right? So he had to do it in some authority, right? And so he asked, and the burning bush told him what? What did the burning bush tell him? Tell him the God I am, the God I am. I am that I am. Now there's only one way to sum that up, okay? That whatever it is, he's it. He is everything. He is the all in all, right? He is the all in all. So Moses down them and over, right? And pulls them out, right? Tough thing. Right? They wander around, they go in, but he takes them into the promised land, doesn't he? He takes them into the promised land. Was it easy? No. You know, and I don't remember the number of tribes that they counted, but when they went into the promised land, now they're in the promised land, right? And now they're encountering tribes. And I think there were, I don't know, it could have been 30, it could have been 3. It's a number. I don't know what it is. Pastor, you have any idea? I don't know what it is. But anyway, when they encountered the promised land, they still had battles to fight. Anybody relate to that? Right? Anybody relate to that? Okay. But God was with them, right? God was with them. So there's my struggle, okay, for the church today. See, I watched this video by Eric Ludi out of California. He pictures this man is sitting in jail, shackles, you know, feet, hands. He's in a jail cell and all that. And he cries out to God. And God comes, and the devil's coming after him. God comes in between, intercedes. The shackles break. He's set free. He's set free in a jail cell, right? Anybody heard that before, right? Right? That's happened, right? That happens. So that's what happens to this gentleman. And guess what? They say that the sign was removed from the prison, and he sat there. He sat there. Okay? Now, we all can kind of laugh, right? And say, well, why? That's pretty stupid, isn't it? Right? You're in a jail cell. You've been set free, right? Why are you sitting there? You're the shackles. You know, this could be a strong word, but I'm just telling you, that's the church today.
Right. So true.
I'm not saying that's everybody here. I'm just saying that's much of the American church today, right? We have been set free by the King of Kings, and our shackles are broken, and we're still sitting in the jail cell. Prison has been removed from the sign.
Yes.
Shackles are gone, and we're sitting there. It's sitting there. And so is it a strong word? Yeah, it's a strong word. But you know what? Our God is a strong God, and He can take us through. You know. And so, you know what? This includes me, guys. I've been much a part of this church. Okay. You know, but God's taken me to a new place. Let me just give you a word of testimony. I come home Friday. God blessed me to close a pretty good sized real estate transaction this week. And it was a blessing. It was a blessing. We like to go out and celebrate when when you deal with one of those, it's like, oh, is it ever gonna close? You know, it was closing 3 times last week and it finally closed, right? And so it was a nice deal. And so we took her mom to Mimi out to dinner and we had a good time and I came home and I want to feel good. And I was miserable in my back and shoulders. I was miserable, okay? I want to just brag on the Lord here a little bit, okay? In about, when John Jenkins was here in last year, I don't remember, June, July, I don't know. He shared something with me. He shared that him and Helen had started taking communion together and that God was doing some really cool things in their lives. And he said, I challenge you to do that. And then not long after that, my brother Bill back there shared the same thing with me. He said, Judy and I have started taking communion together, and God's doing some pretty cool things. You ought to try it. And, a week or so ago, I decided it's time. It's time. It's revival, right? It's time, right? It's time to do something different, right? It's these things that I've been thinking about since June of last year, right? You know, whatever you've been thinking about, it's time. It's time. Okay, so Friday I was miserable. Everything from here right out into there was on fire, okay? On fire. And so that was Friday night. Well, I woke up yesterday morning, and I'm just telling you that it's like my back and shoulders have not felt this good in 12 years, 13 years. So, and we've been praying for healing for many of you and for ourselves, right? But God is a good God. He's a healing God. And I still have a little twinge there today, but I'm telling you, it feels an amazing. I'm just telling you, supernaturally better. How can I say it that way? Okay. So whatever you've been thinking about for 6 months, okay, 9 months, whatever the Lord has been prompting you in, it's time. It's time to move into that. Okay. It's time to move into that. Okay. So to do that, all right. God reveals himself to us, as I told you. When I was standing over here on this edge of the cross, I was learning about who God is, what his character is, okay? And so I learned he was, okay, I needed financial help, right? I learned he was Jehovah Jireh, right? And so I grabbed hold of that, right? I'm just being truthful here. I grabbed hold of that. You're my provider? Okay, I'll take that, you know what I mean? And then, you know, salvation, you're Jehovah Shuati, yes? I'll take that also. You're God of salvation? I'll take that also. So I took it, you know? And so, you know, but, you know, for us to grow in the Lord, we have to be able to make those changes. We need to understand who our God is. Okay? Okay? And I'll just say it now. The title of this message is, He is I Am. Okay? Yes. He is I Am. We have, for us to be, the Spirit of God to be moving in us so that we can be the I Am who we are in Christ, we have to understand who He is. Okay, who the He is. So I want to stop and read a scripture to you, and it says, "Let them praise the name of the Lord." Okay, for His name alone is exalted; His majesty is above earth and heaven. His name is to be exalted. Yes. He is to be exalted, and I'm not talking about one name. See, the name in the Jewish, okay, in the Hebrew, in the Jewish, right, is very important. Okay, it's not like us. Okay, we just, okay, you know, George Jr., okay, you know, he's our son, we'll name him George Jr., okay. You know, when they name somebody in the Hebrew, it has great meaning. It has great significance, okay? It's not uncommon, right, to have a name that has a 6 or an 8 or a 10 behind it, right? They're the 10th, okay? They're the 10th of that name, and I'm trying to think of a Jewish name. Somebody can probably help me with that, but whatever a male's name. But anyway, the name is important in the Hebrew family. It's not like America, okay? Like when Ari was born, I appreciated the fact that I know in the church this happens a lot where the mother digs into these books and finds out the significance of that name. It's important, right? And that you not only look at them with that name, but the importance of what that name means. And so that's important to God, right? And so when we call him Jehovah Rapha, our healer, okay, that's important.
Yes, it is.
It's important. It's real, okay? And so we have to know those characteristics of the God who he is. If I need healing over here on this side of the cross, okay, I need to know he's on both sides, right? Remember that? Okay, he's on both sides. I don't want to miss you, okay? He's over here right after I'm saved also. But over here, I need to know that Jehovah Rapha, right, is my healer. I can trust him to be healed. And if I can do that, then I can pray to him. Right, and I can count and believe on being healed. If I'm in financial need, and I know that I have a God named Jehovah Jireh, whatever, you know what I mean? I can trust.
Yes.
I can trust, right? So in Old Testament time, names were not given not only as an identification, but many times as a special meaning was attached to the name. Exodus 3:13 through 15. Then Moses asked God, "If I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what should I tell them?" God replied to Moses, "I am who I am." I don't know what your need is. I don't know what your need is. I don't know what God is speaking to you as far as change that he wants to make in your life. Okay? But I do know this. He is the God that will help you do it, right? He will do it through you, right? And so he is. So this is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say this to the Israelites, Yahweh, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever. Forever. This is how I am to be remembered in every generation. Every generation. But the scriptures constantly remind us that naming God matters. For instance, God asked Moses to bring his people, the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, out of captivity in Egypt. So Moses asked God for some identification. Tell them I am who I am. Amen? So who is God to you? Who is God to you today, in your need, in where you are? I know for five people, he is God Yeshua. He's the God of their salvation this week, right? Because they were saved last week, amen? And I know that's the case for many or most, if not all of you here, okay? So, and if that is the case, he is our Most High God. He's the all-sufficient one, right? He's Master, Lord of Peace. He will provide. We have to know who our God is. We have to know. The notes that I gave you, whether you got them on the way in or you get them on the way out, is just a small sampling of who God is, right? A listing of the God who is, okay? Okay, this afternoon I'm going to put a posting on Facebook, okay? And it's by the same organization, Ellerslie Discipleship Training. And it goes through the whole Bible, okay, speaking who God is. It runs about, I don't know, 17 minutes or something like that. But I want to pass that along to you. It's a powerful thing. We have to know. We have to know who he is, right? We have to know who he is, and we need to worship. So 15 names of God that I put on the list, you can read that 15 into a month. Is you can read it twice, right? And just that list of 15. El Shaddai, Lord God Almighty. El Elyon, the Most High God. Adonai, Lord Master. Yahweh, Lord Jehovah. Jehovah, the Lord my banner. Jehovah Ra, the Lord my shepherd. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that heals. Jehovah Shammah, the Lord that is there. Jehovah Tsidkenu, the Lord our righteousness. Jehovah Mekadesh, the Lord who sanctifies you. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide. Jehovah Shalom, the Lord is peace. Jehovah Sabbath, the Lord of hosts. Elohim, God creator. El Yeshuati, the God of salvation, where the word Yeshua comes from. God, our salvation. This just reading these words can transform your life. Just reading that page that's out there can change your life. It can change your life. It will build trust in your God. It will help you to understand he's real. And this is not only for you, it's for me too. I read these things. I want to know who the God is. That is my Savior, right? That I am entrusting my life to, okay? And so, and when I do that, his power and his presence and all of those attributes come through that cross and over to me, all right? Okay? They come over to me, and I indwell his presence, right? And so on the other side of the cross, we have I ams, who we are in God, right? I am, and I created another list for you, okay? Now, I will tell you, this list, I have very effectively used this list in counseling. People come and talk to me, right? There's 30 of them, and people in a depression can read that for a week and come out of depression, okay? So if you're depressed, you're down, those words, the power of God's word will take you out of it, okay? It will transform your life just reading these words. You hear me? Okay, I'm just telling, it's the truth. Okay, and so if you're in a good place, right, and you want to read these words, guess what? Praise God, good things are coming, right? And we should embrace these things. We should embrace who he is. And not only that, but when I talked about You know, the prisoner sitting in the prison cell, he's sitting there with the chains broken and everything because he doesn't know who he is in God. I remember the first time I met Pastor Ricky, okay? We went to FATS and we had a discussion, and I was considering coming and being a part of the, not the staff, but just coming and being a part of the church. And we were sitting at FATS, and I remember we're about to leave, and we're having a lot of discussions about people and God and changing and challenges and stuff. You know, and we both looked at each other and just said, you know, if people really understood who they are in Christ, these problems would go away, right? These challenges would go away. And that's the truth, right? We just need to know. So there are 30 of them. Read them. Let me give you this. As you read through them, okay, you need to add a few words to these things, right? That just state your trust and your belief. So I'm just throwing these things out. You make your own words. I believe in the Word of God. This is what the Word of God says about me. I can trust that God's Word is holy and that I can trust that God can make these transformations in my life. I believe each of these declarations about me, and I believe it to be true in my life, okay? That's just personalizing what God's Word says. So I gave you 30 of them. I'm going to read a couple of them. I'm not going to go into the detail of the Scripture, but there's 30 of them out there. Number two, if you got the list with you, number two says, I am filled with joy because Christ is my strength.
Yes.
Is that healing?
Yes.
Is that strengthening? Is that just to read that? And to know that the Word of God is true and it's holy and it's real and that you can trust that that is happening in your life. Number four, I am His beloved. We're beating that to death over at the men's ministry, right? I am His beloved. We are the word we used, infused, we are infusing that, okay? I am His beloved, okay? So men, I invite you. That is foundational, as Paul said. That is foundation. I am His beloved. Okay? I am marked by God, number seven. Number nine, I am alive with Christ.
Yes.
Number 12, I am healed. It works. I just gave testimony to that. I am secure in Christ. Number 15, I am no longer a slave to fear. I'm no longer a slave to fear. 30, I am His. I'm His. I belong to Him. He's mine. He's going to take care of me. He's going to take care of everything. Whatever happens in my life, He's going to take care of it. See, the only way that we can make these direct declarations is with power. With power is to recognize that He is, right? He is the I am.
Yes.
Okay, if we believe that He is the I am and that He is to us, then we can declare these I ams about ourselves, right? Because He is living inside of us, right? So we're only declaring it about Him because He's inside of us. Amen?
That's right.
Does that make sense? Yes. I am because He is. So let me say that again. I am because He is. Without the cross in the middle of these declarations, they're nothing but ink on paper. When I believe the Scriptures about the cross and that Jesus died on the cross and paid the penalty for my sins, these words become powerful. The Spirit that is inside of me makes them come alive. But if I don't read them, they are ink on paper. But if I don't believe them, they are ink on paper. But if I don't believe that He is the things that I just told you, there is no power. There's no power. But if we believe, I like to read it in a positive sense, right? But if I believe that He is, there's power. Amen. I got that bottle of water and never even used it. So, we have the cross. We have a God that is the I am. He's everything to you and to me. And the result of those two things, we can declare that we are all of those declarations that we discuss. So, we have a revival, right? We have revival. Do we? Do we have a revival? Is what we are doing, is it revival? Is it revival? Yes, it is revival, right? But does revival end here? Does it end with, did it end last Sunday for 6 days? Will it end after today for 6 days? Will it end on April 25th? Revival is ongoing in the power of belief, is it not? And I say this in all love to my church. I love you, hear me, love, I love you. I believe that revival is more about what you and I do with what Paul Lane spoke last week, okay? With what I am saying this week, with what Paul McGinnis will say next week, and on and on and on, right? April 26th, 27th, 28th, 29th, November 4th, yes. December 12th, right? January 1st. Amen? That's why I want to read you this scripture. I pray, this is one of my favorite verses in all the Bible. I've told you this in the past. I pray that he may grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power in the inner man, in the inner man, yes. In the inner man, yes. In the inner man, through his spirit. See, it's in the inner man. It's in the inner man that we need to be changed. Here in Ephesus chapter 3, God gives us a powerful vision of the church of Ephesus that needs to be strengthened in the inner man. How? Through his spirit, and that the spirit is coming. The spirit is coming. Revival. I want to share with you in closing, this will be a little bit challenging. It was challenging for me, but this man, Dallas Willard, wrote this book, Renovation of the Heart. It's about transformation. This guy is a sage. He's with the Lord now, but he a great wisdom, great, great wisdom. I just, there are people that just, he's an amazing man. So he shares about transformation and revival, and he talks about becoming more Christ-like, and he states very plainly, very bluntly, that the church is struggling with that, okay, as I've just said, that the church is struggling with being Christ-like, right? And he says the solution to it is three things, okay? One, vision. We must have an adequate vision. Personally, I must have an adequate vision of what God is doing in my life. Yes. Okay? And I'll just say this, okay? That you should be seeking, I should be seeking a vision for what God is doing in your life through these next 6 weeks. Yes. Okay? What does it look like on the other side? What is the vision, right? Okay, when Moses was encountering God on the mount, right? And he said, I am that I am, right? He gave him a vision, right? The vision was, Moses, you will, and remember, Moses was struggling with this, right? He didn't go in his own power. He went in the power of the I am, right? And that's the only way he would have done that, okay? And so Moses is to go get them and take them into the promised land. That's a big vision, all right? That's a big vision. So I don't know what your vision is, okay? But I can tell you on, let's just say May 1st, you should have a vision. You should be asking the Lord through these 6 weeks, God, what do you want my life to look like on the other side of this? You know, Paul has already made a statement that John Jenkins would come here, right? And let's declare that. That's a good thing, right? Let's declare that he will come to a new church. Well, if he's coming to a new church, guess what? We need to be a different people, don't we, right? We need to be a different people. So ask the Lord, what is his vision for you on the other side? Right? Because let's don't have this be a series of meetings and on May 1st we look the same.
That's right.
Right? Let's be a different people. Let's be a real church. Not that we're not a real church, but God is always growing. He's always moving. Right? He's always growing, the kingdom of God. Okay, vision. Two, intent. You must make a decision to fill in the blank. whatever that may be, to increase your devotions, to start a devotion, to begin a prayer life, to show up on Monday nights for prayer, to come on Wednesday nights, whatever it may be just to pray. Pray for a person, whatever, it's personal. But you need to talk to God about what that is and say, and make a decision to do that, right? And then means you have a vision, you're committed to doing it, how will you complete it, okay? How will you complete it? And you need to be very flexible in that, right? Here's what happens to the kingdom of God in the church, okay? We set goals and things are too difficult, and we don't flex. Right? We don't flex. It ain't working this way. Let's back up. Let's change this. We quit. I'm not just saying the church. I'm just saying me, us as individuals, right? We okay, come to prayer on a Monday night. Okay, well, that didn't work. Okay, well, come again. Try it again. Maybe it's a bad night. You know what I mean? Maybe, you know, Carol ate the wrong thing. I don't know. You know what I'm saying? But something, try again. Try something different, right? Try something, do it different. So we have a vision. We must have intent. So vision, intentional is I made a decision. I am choosing to do this. It's a practice to be honest with ourselves about our intentions. We have to be honest with ourselves. We have to talk to the Lord and be honest about what's going on with the communication between ourselves and Him, right? And be honest. The church has got to quit saying we are set in our ways and we cannot change.
Yes.
We can change.
Yes.
We can change. We can grow. We can expand. We can love more people. We can be loved by more people, right? We can change. We are too old. We are too young. I won't try. I haven't decided. We got to get rid of these excuses. There's so many people that need love, and we need to be loved by them. You know, I want a bunch more people to be loved, to love me, right? I want a bigger family. You're my family. I love you. I want a bigger family. When I kick the bucket, I want a whole bunch of people to love on her, right? We want a bigger family, right? We want to make a difference in this world. We are making, and we want to make a greater difference in this world. So means are practical steps of achieving the vision, the steps that you've decided to take. You have to be flexible. If the steps are too big, be ready to adjust. It has to be something you can do. The most change happens in multiple steps. Now listen to this. Most change happens in multiple steps of doing something for small amounts of time. You hear that? Most change happens in multiple steps of doing something for small amounts of time,
yes.
Right? Just small amounts of time. 10 minutes in the morning, I'm praying for this church. I'm praying for the leadership. I'm praying for whatever. Consistently, lots and lots of time, small amount of time. Let me give you an example, vision. Father, I have a vision of you pouring into me an understanding of you, your power, your peace, and your provision. I will give you the glory for what you are going to do in my life. My intention, I have decided that knowing all of your attributes will bring great change to my life.
Yes.
Means I will read the names of God in my Bible. I will find a resource that will help me to worship who He is. I will ask for help in discovering who God really is in my life. Sometimes we just need to ask for help, right? We can't figure it all out ourselves. I can't do that. None of us can, right? I mean, we need to ask for help. Someone asked you to stand. Please stand. I want to ask you to stand.
Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Thank you, Father.
I believe God wants to do something great in our lives this morning. I do. Great things were done last week, and but I believe that God wants us to know who He really is, and He wants you to know that the God that He is inside of you, and that He wants to use you in so many ways. He wants to lift you up out of that jail cell and let you run around screaming, "I am free! I am free. I'm free indeed, right? And God, you can do these things through me. You can touch lives. You can use me, Lord God. It's I just need to yield to you. I need to yield to you. So I'm just going to ask you. I'm going to ask you. If this word is spoken to you and you're going to make a commitment to this revival of just really digging in to the truth of what's being spoken to you, not just today, okay, but what was spoken last week. You know what? That thing's on YouTube for a reason.
Yes.
It's there for a reason. It can be played over and over and over again, right? And you can take a notepad and you can make notes, right? And you can get that thing inside of you, right? Pen to pad through the mind is transforming, okay? So if you are, I want you to do this, to just ask the Lord for a vision.
Yes.
A vision of what your life is going to look like.
Yes.
On May 1st,
yes.
Okay? That there's going to be change in your life. I believe there's going to be change in each of yours' life, okay? Yours is not a word. Y'all's, each of you, how's that? There's going to be change. I want you to believe that, right?
Change.
That there's going to be change in all of our lives on May 1st,
yes.
Right? Amen? And so ask the Lord, Lord, I'm going to ask him right now. Lord, you hear from our church family right now, Lord God, each and every one of us, Lord. You hear from each and every one of us, Lord God. We want to know what you're up to in our life.
Yes.
What you're doing in our lives, Lord. And we commit to being real about this revival. We commit to being real about it. We commit to what you want to do in our lives over these 6 weeks, 7 weeks.
Yes.
And Lord God, we look with expectation and anticipation, Lord God, with excitement of what's going to be in our life,
yes.
Lord God, on
yes.
May 1st, Lord.
Yes.
We look to that with excitement, Lord God. And so, Father, have your way. We sing that all the time,
yes.
But are we real about it?
Yes.
Have your way in us, Lord. Have your way in us, Father. That John and Helen Jenkins, Father, would see a transformed church, and that they would even take us to a new level.
Yes.
You know what? Let's impart something
yes.
to them.
Yes.
Let's impart something to them when they come. So I'm just asking you, if you would seek the Lord's vision over these coming weeks as God would instill to you, okay? And then there's intention. So that's vision. Then there's intention that says, I will. I am. It's not I think, I might. It's I will.
Yes.
I am committed. I commit to doing this. That's intent. And then the means. Lord, give me the means. Whatever it may be, Lord, give me the means. Do I need to find some time on a Sunday afternoon to watch these messages again? Do I need to start taking notes? Do I need to seek pastor and just talk to him about this? Do I need to talk to any of the pastors about any of this? Do I need to just talk with them about this vision? Do I need some help with this vision thing? We're here to help one another, amen? We're here. So vision, Lord, give us a vision that will come true, Lord God. And don't limit to May 1st if the Lord's giving you something bigger. It's okay, okay? But we want this revival to be life transforming, to be changing, right, in all of our lives. For me, I'm speaking to myself also. So, Father God, we ask you to give us the means. So I just say to you, if you're willing to commit to that, I want you to raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Just raise your hand if you're willing to commit to that.
Yes.
There's hands all over the place.
Yes.
All over the place. Let us, Lord, do what you want in us. Do what you want in us. I want to close with this. This is Dallard Willis's closing of this particular book, and it says, if we are to be spiritually formed in Christ, we must have and must implement the appropriate vision, intention, and means. Not just any path will do. See, we just take any old path, don't we? Let's let the path come from the Lord. Let him give us the path.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
If this vision, intention, and means pattern is not put into place properly and held there, Christ simply will not be formed in us. Now, I don't like to finish on a negative, but I'm leaving it there. I'm just telling you guys, that's the truth. So the inverse of that, I'll go ahead and finish on a positive, is, right, that if we will, Christ will be formed in us. Christ will be formed in us, right? And we will touch. And I'll get a job as a missions pastor because some things happened in this county, right? Amen.
Yes.
Father God, we thank you for your time, Lord God. Thank you for your word, Lord God. Thank you for your word that we can look at these 15 names of God, Lord God, that we can look at these 30 I am confirmations, Lord God, that as we read these things, we can believe in our hearts and our lives that these things are real and they're true in our lives, Lord. I have been made in God's image. I am free. I am redeemed. I am victorious. I am gifted. I am seated in heavenly places with Christ. I'm a citizen of heaven. I am one in the Spirit with Lord. I am the branch of the one and the only vine. I am the salt and light of the world. I am the city on a hill, and I cannot be hidden. I'm an ambassador to God, and I am his. Father God, we thank you for your word. We love you, Lord. And Father, we receive your love back to us, Lord God, that we might have the power, that love that flows through us, Lord God, we might have the power and the love to touch your world, Lord God.
Yes.
In Jesus' mighty and holy name, amen. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. Amen.
Celebrate that word. Amen. George, I was thinking as you were speaking that, you know, the word, I knew earlier when I said something about sealing, I felt that it was something there in that, but I see that even as you're speaking, that we live underneath the ceiling of how we see God, of how we see ourselves because of the way we see God. And we'll never again break through even that ceiling unless we really begin to behold who God is and understand. What a powerful word to know that we'll never be able, even on that right side of the cross, mm-hmm. to know what we have in God mm-hmm. until we understand who God is, and then we understand who we are in Him. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Yeah,
for
watch
that
video I posted on the on our Grace Chapel page today. He is, and it goes through the whole Bible.
Amen.
It's changing. It's life changing.
Praise God.
Amen.
Shout victory.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we love you, and we look forward to. Listen, these are revival words. You know, we've been geared over the years, if we were not cutting flips and shouting and things, and that's not revival, but that's really a momentary lift up. We're talking about a thing over these weeks, as George said this morning, that we will never look back again, that we'll never be the same again, that our lives would be revived and changed by the power of Almighty God. That's what I'm looking for, amen? You know, we can... again, if that's all revival is, you can have one every moment as far as just a good time. But I want something that I can burn those boats, George.
Amen.
Amen. I want something I can burn those boats and say, I'm never going back there. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to go and cross the finish line the way God intended me to cross. Amen.
Amen.
So we love you. Remember the announcements that Paul gave us, announcements in the bulletin. And tomorrow night prayer, Wednesday night Bible study, and just seeking the Lord, praying for one another. I pray for Clint McGinnis as he has surgery this week, Lord, in Jesus' name, that surgery will go well. Father, that they'll be able to repair his shoulder, and God, there will be total victory there, and God, your peace and grace will be with him. Lord Leonard Tessenier, as he goes through the biopsies this week, God, that on his blood vessels, Lord, that God, you will be with there, bring healing to him, and Father, to every other one again in this house that needs anything, Lord, let us see who you are and who we are in you and what we have because of that in Jesus' name. Amen. I love you. Blessings to you. Amen.